Hi guys, Jonathan Graham here for Guitar Interactive magazine. We are here at the Savoy Hotel with the one and only Vivian Campbell from so many bands, Def Leppard, Last in Line. How are you doing today, buddy?
I'm doing great. If you were talking to me today in my capacity as guitarist in Last in Line, it would be the Holiday Inn Express and not the Savoy. Just want to point that out.
Well, when you can pull the clout of both acts, you can you can do that.
Well, we're very fortunate. It's a lovely setting. It's a lovely cozy chair.
That's it. Now, you know, we're here especially because you've got a fantastic book that's coming out, and you're going to be celebrating it tonight just over the river there at Royal Festival Hall. Now, with definitely the book, I mean, this is, well, it's 40 years plus in the making, 30 years for you with the band, of course. Mm-hmm. You know, when did the idea kick off that it was time to put pen to paper?
Well, these things are never our ideas. It's always some grown-up comes in and says, hey, what about, you know, and in fairness, so many of the time we said, no, or now is not the time or whatever, but now it does feel like the time. It feels appropriate, you know. I think we're sufficiently seasoned, you know. If we were a dish in the oven, it would be like, okay, yeah, it's starting to get a little brown on top, you know. So there's plenty to tell, you know. There's plenty of stories. As you say, it's 40 plus years. It's 31 plus for me as the new guy, you know. There's a lot of history there, and you know, some of it is dull as dishwater, but I mean, other stories are just priceless, you know. We've had good times, we've had bad times. Obviously, I think the bad times have been more documented than the good times.
Sure.
For Def Leppard, but, you know, there's a lot of humor in this band. I mean, they're funny guys, and we have some funny times. And indeed, with any band, when, you know, we call it submarine duty, when you're with a band and you're on tour, you're in a bus or a plane, whatever the vehicle is.
Sure.
You're in some cylindrical tube traveling at velocity from point A to B, you know, and... you know, you've got to have humor to endure it, to make it work, you know, and those are often the best moments, to be honest. I mean, there's some really, really priceless moments. So hopefully, you know, there are some of those moments in the book, and there you go.
Well, you know, I've managed to get my hands on a few excerpts, you know, ahead of time to be able to, you know, check out some of the goodness that's in there in the book. And of course, it is difficult as a fan of so many years to read some of these bits and not picture, you know, like a film or something like that of some of these things being reenacted. Now, of course, with like the Motley Crue stuff that came out a couple of years ago and all that different stuff, all these dramatizations, I know there has been, you know, a Def Leppard one in the past that wasn't the best movie, let's be honest, but I feel like a remake could be in order. Is that something that people float around you guys, turning this into an actual series?
No, they've yet to actually mention that one, but I just hope nobody would expect us to act. Yeah. We'd be a little bit wooden. Hey, how does that make you feel, Joe?
you could be, just a band in the background, you know,
I think we already did that last year with Bank at Dave, to be honest. Did I drop a name there? You know, which was a lot of fun. I mean, that totally happened out of the blue. We just happened to be here and somebody said, hey, they're doing this movie and is there any chance, you know? So I think we'll take baby steps in that direction. We're going to focus on the music for now.
Fair enough.
And you guys, you know, you've been, you know, prolific once again, you know, and being in the studio and releasing stuff. It seems like that whole, I'll only mention it once, COVID period, you know, it did light a little bit of a fire in terms of from the perspective that you guys found a new way of working together. You were doing stuff remotely, stuff was starting to work, and of course we had Diamond Star Halos last year. You guys are back with Drastic Symphonies, you know, which of course is, you know, reimagining some of these great tracks. Before we go in, you know, depth and working with, you know, the Royal Symphony Orchestra and, you know, bringing these to life as they are, I mean, are we going to continue to hear some new music from Def Leppard? Because it feels like you guys are just, you know, you're just getting started.
Yeah, you know, in fairness, you know, it was Joe's idea, like when the tour was postponed in 2020, and we knew for sure we weren't going to be working that year, you know, Joe said, well, instead of sitting around scratching our balls, really make a record.
Yeah.
So, and then the next question was, well, we can't travel. How are we going to do that? Well, you know, get the technology. For me, I'm the one who's way behind the technology curve of the band. I mean, I am a total Luddite with tech. I'm fearful of it. So it was time to get back on on that horse anyway, you know, so I'm glad I was sort of pushed in that direction. But it was a bit of a steep learning curve for me. It's like, what's this? You know, how does this work? Where do I plug in? And, you know, having to do it all on your own because it's COVID and you can't even, you know, call a clever friend to come over to the house and help you. Not that I have any friends, John. Kid.
People are heartbroken.
But anyway, so you know, once I got beyond that, I started slowly. And that's the other great thing about doing the Diamond Star Halos the way we did was there was no schedule. So it was okay to start slow because nobody was saying, hey, where's that file? Yeah. You know, we need that. So it was open-ended. And creatively, that was a good aspect of it because, you know, as a guitarist, I don't tend to spend too much time on the front end of thinking about guitar solos, you know, and I'd hear the song and I'd try and imagine a bit of something. I'd get a sound together, get levels, play it a few times. And, you know, to be honest, you know, I'm experienced enough now I can get something passable quickly. But then, you know, instead of sending it off right away, I'd say, I'm just going to sit on that and come back tomorrow. And I'd come back the next day and listen to it and I'd think, oh, I didn't hear that yesterday. This could be that. Could be so much better. So, you know, to be able to take your time with it and then get it to a standard that you actually think, okay, that's as good as it's going to get for this. So that was a bit of a luxury. And it was also during that period that the idea came to do this Drastic Symphonies record. And to be honest, that idea came from a grown-up at the record company here in the UK. So that was floated to us, and we thought, well, actually, that sounds really interesting for two reasons. Number one, that the quality of musicians at the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra, I mean, they're pretty good. I've heard about them for a few years. So we knew that was going to be the pinnacle. I mean, that's as good as it gets. And to do it in Abbey Road was just, you know, the cherry on the cake. But the other reason was they said it doesn't have to be your greatest hits. You can go deep, go into album cuts, go into more obscure stuff. Having said that, they did give us some pushback when we told them we couldn't get Pour Some Sugar on Me to work with an orchestra, which we knew from the get-go. We knew it was going to sound ponderous and ridiculous, but you know,
you're pouring too much sugar on.
Exactly. Yeah, it was just going to be stiff sounding. And we tried, and then we went back and we said, "That's not going to work. We're not going to do it." And they kind of pushed back a bit and said, "Well, it was your biggest ever song. You might want to reconsider." And you know, this is where the title of the album came from, because we realized at that point that we had to do quote unquote a drastic reinterpretation of that particular song if we were going to put on the record. And fortunately, we had one in our back pocket. M. Griner is a Canadian singer-songwriter, friend of ours for many, many, many years. And many, many years ago, we heard her do a version of Pour Some Sugar on Me that's radically different. So we ended up doing a duet version of that with M, Joe singing, and the rest of us basically going to the pub, you know, and watching them. Yeah. And, you know, so that we got on there. But then there's other cuts on the record that are, you know, a bit more left field. There's Paper Sun from the Euphoria record of 1999, which is a big old epic rock track that just works gloriously with the orchestra. It just gives it so much more drama and depth. You know, Turn to Dust, which was on the Slang album from 1997, you know, is something that not a lot of people would know, but it lends itself perfectly to this sort of situation and this interpretation. And then, you know, there's other songs that were no-brainers, basically, you know, Love Bites, Hysteria, you know, those are the sort of songs you can just imagine. It's so easy to do a string arrangement for a song like that. So those were the easy ones. And then, you know, some of the more straightforward rock tracks, you know, Rock of Ages didn't work. Again, just sounds ridiculous with an orchestra.
But are you saying that exists somewhere?
I hope not. And if it does, burn it. You know, Too Late for Love, Joe had to re-record the vocals. You know, the rest of the record was put together using the original masters and stripping away and remixing and whatnot, with the exception of Pour Some Sugar, obviously. But Too Late for Love, the verse vocal is way up here, which sounds great underneath a rock band. But when you just have an orchestra and Joe singing way, way up there, it's like, you know, that's not going to work. So Joe went in and re-recorded the verse vocal an octave lower, and all of a sudden it made perfect sense. So things like that we had to go through to make certain songs work. Other songs like Animals, a great example, where you just basically strip it all away. And Joe's verse vocal and that, the sound of his voice in the verses of Animal is so, so good. And to hear it in that context with just this beautiful orchestra underneath it, and the voice really, really shines. And it really gives the song a whole new meaning and a new lease on life. And then as the song progresses, you know, the band slowly starts to come back in. You know, a lot of times we had to replace the drums, again, going back to Too Late for Love, you know, take the drums out, but replace it with timpani parts, you know, putting the accents in different places. Mm. So, you know, it was fun to do it. And certain songs, like I say, lent themselves to it easily, and other songs were a bit more of a challenge. And we were fortunate that we have a good working arrangement with a guy called Eric Gorfin, who's a string arranger that we worked with and known for many, many years. And Eric's a great guy, really easy to work with, really hardworking. And Eric would do the mock-ups in his home studio in LA, and what he thought was a good arrangement, he'd send it to us, and then we'd do the back and forth and say, this works, this doesn't work, more violins here, more cellos there, or less this, less that. So, you know, we were sort of, to a certain extent, executive producers of this record. You know, and like I said, there wasn't really a lot of re-recording. Joe just had to do some work, and the rest was fun at the pub.
I think it's a real triumph, but in particular because of the fact that when you think of Def Leppard records, there's not exactly an awful lot of space left on there sonically. And you know, some acts, you know, thrive on that there's just, you know, a certain, and there's you can hear it, some certain acts you could think are at the space to add this or a little bit more, but there's not much space left on there. So that, you know, for you guys working on it and the producers working on it, it really must have been a real task to make that work. And it's great that it has.
Well, we're not known for being subtle, you know. Yeah. It's there's always been a lot of bombast and pretty much everything that Def Leppard does. So it was an interesting mental exercise to try and do the reverse, you know, and try and take things away and then find the key elements of the songs that you could actually hang your hat on.
Of course, the rest of the time you've just been doing nothing, haven't you? Of course, now you're prolific with Last in Line, and I mean, you guys have been putting out some great music. The EP dropped last year, you're back with Jericho, and you know, I've got to say, I mean, seeing you guys for the first time live, probably maybe about 6 or 7 years ago or something like that, totally blew me away with the energy, the vibe, absolutely loved it. But the thing that's really struck me with Jericho is, you know, and I mean this in the nicest possible way, it's like you've stepped away from the Dio thing. Do you know what I mean? Mm. It's no longer in any way some sort of trip. This feels just like a band that happens to be called Last in Line.
Yeah.
And this is a whole new direction for you guys. Was that a conscious effort to make?
No. I mean, that's kind of always where it was. Well, not always where it was going. I mean, I wouldn't have named it Last in Line if I kind of had the foresight to know that we were going to be doing this. But, that, you know, the it started as a fun thing. And then it was like, let's do some shows locally. We were all living in LA at the time. We no longer do, but at that time, 10 years ago, we were.
Yeah.
And it was literally just, let's play some songs from the first three Dio albums in a few clubs around LA on occasion when it suits everyone.
Yeah.
And it was after a year or two of that it grew. You know, we were offered shows in here in Europe and Japan and in North America as well. You know, we sort of grew, and because it was named Last in Line, and because Vinny and Jimmy Bain and myself were, you know, the three surviving members of the original band,
of course,
it was obvious that people viewed it as a tribute thing. And that initially it was that we were in tribute to the music we wrote and recorded with Ronnie, with Andy Freeman singing. But when we were offered a record deal, it became something else. Okay, well, let's do something in that style. And that our first record, Heavy Crown, was, you know, there's a few songs in that record that are very reminiscent of the original Dio band.
Yeah.
You know, those sort of big sort of halftime tempos, you know, big ponderous.
It felt a bit like unfinished, like what could have been sort of thing, you know?
Yeah, indeed. You could hear Ronnie singing on some of that stuff. And then there were other songs on the record that showed Andy's influence a bit more, you know, they're a bit more modern leaning. And then on the second album, it, you know, we lost Jimmy Bain right before the release of our first album, Heavy Crown. We continued with Phil Susanna, used to play with Ozzy.
Sure.
And between having Andrew and Phil there, that sort of pushed us more in a different sort of direction. I mean, when Vinny and I play, like if it was just Vinny and me in a room, we tend to go back into that regressive, that Dio, that classic hard rock, heavy metal thing, you know? And that's just the way Vinny plays. I mean, he's such an incredible drummer. He's so inspiring to me. As a guitarist, he really raises my game because he plays these things and you think, okay, this is what it is. And then he totally inverts it and brings it somewhere else. Yeah. Goes double time, goes, you know, offbeat, triplets thing. He's like, whoa, whoa, whoa. You got to be paying attention when you play with Vinny, and the energy that he brings to it really elevates everyone he plays with. Yeah. So, you know, and that's how we write. We don't think a lot about what we're doing. We're not trying to reinvent the wheel. We're not trying to write a hit song. And we don't have a budget or a lot of time. So when we get together to do that, it's like, we've got 4 hours. We need to write and record 3 songs. Let's go, you know? So yeah. it happens really, really quick. And then we get together and we cut the track. And we have to cut the track live. That's a big, big part of what we do. The basic track has to be cut where we can make eye contact, because there is that dynamic, that push-pull, especially, you know, like I said, with what Vinny does, that you can't replicate by sending in files. The way Def Leppard does, you know, that's an entirely different animal. So, yeah. It was great. This record Jericho was a challenge though, because we literally started January of 2020, and we recorded the first 6 songs in LA, and then of course COVID. And
these tracks go that far back?
Yeah, well, the first 6 do. Yeah, the first 6 basic tracks were cut then,
yeah.
And then it came to a full stop. We didn't finish the tracks. Andy didn't write the vocals. I didn't record any more guitars.
Yeah.
We just had those 6 basic tracks sitting for a while, and then we picked it up again in early 22. Actually, it was just last year. Got together in Las Vegas, wrote and recorded another 6 songs. Then took it all home. Andy did all his vocals at home. I did all the supplemental guitar parts, guitar solos in hotel rooms at the very start of the Def Leppard tour last June. And so that was it. And that was Jericho. And we're really pleased with it. I mean, every record that the Last in Line has done has shown this progression. And I'm happy to hear that, you know, as an observer, yeah. Listener, now you now think that it represents something different. If we weren't called Last in Line, we wouldn't have this.
No.
This. I won't call it baggage. It's a double-edged sword. I mean, you know, nobody's more entitled to play those songs than Vinny and I, being the last surviving guys. Yeah. You know, and they were songs that we wrote with Ronnie. So, and nobody will play them better than Vinny and I. And we still play, you know, even though it's our 3rd album, we still play maybe 25 to 35% of the show is songs from those early Dio records, you know. And it's a joy to play them. They really integrate well with the original Last in Line material, you know. So it's a very, very dynamic band, and it's no 2 shows are ever the same.
100%, you know, if you guys are in town, I'm there with a bullet, and, you know, it's an incredible live show. Just touching on that a little bit about, you know, some people's perceptions on stuff like that and how people can be judgmental. I'm assuming that for you guys, though, there can't be much backlash. I mean, anybody who knows Dio and knows that you know how important you were to those early records, they must be overwhelming.
I'd like to think so. I still think there's a lot of misunderstanding out there, you know, because for many, many years after my time with Dio, it was always thought that I had quit the band, that I turned my back on the band, and that was not true. I was fired from the band in the middle of the Sacred Heart tour. I did not want to leave that band. It meant a lot to me. I was definitely pushing Ronnie's buttons in a couple of ways. Number one was with the original arrangement he had made with us that he was reneging on. Number two was the creative aspect. I was definitely wanting to explore other musical options, whereas I know Ronnie was very, very set in his ways. And I totally understand that. I mean, that was part of what made that band what it was. But for me, there was definitely a clear generational gap. I was in my early 20s. Even when I was fired, I would say I was 23. You know, so for me, it was like I was still growing as a musician. I was still absorbing a lot of different influences. And whereas Ronnie was, you know, obviously more seasoned in his career and very set in what he wanted to do. So, you know, it was an awkward sort of relationship musically and personally.
Yeah.
I won't deny that, but I did not leave the band. I mean, I did not want to leave the band. And then for many years it was portrayed that, oh, Viv turned his back, he quit. And that was never the case. So I think there's still some people out there who actually
believe
that.
The true story.
Who see me and they say, what an asshole, you know, he quit Dio to go play with Def Leppard and stay at the Savoy Hotel. Did I mention we're at the Savoy?
And the Winston Churchill Suite, I would say. I know you guys, you think about, you know, you do so much new stuff and new music and it's all about the future, but just touch on a couple of things as a fan, because they mean an awful lot to me. One is this hearing aid track that you did with Jimmy and Ronnie, and it was a big project, and you guys put some, you know, magic together in there with this track. A lot of people, a lot of names involved. What are some of your memories of putting that project together and making it work? And there's got to have been some crazy moments with all those guys.
Yeah, there were. So when we did that, we were at Rumble Recorders in LA recording the Sacred Heart album. And it was a really dark time for Ronnie and for the band. I mean, nobody wanted to be around Ronnie. Ronnie and Wendy had split up. They weren't getting divorced, but they were living separate lives, and Ronnie's mood was really, really dark. And the big difference between the Sacred Heart album and Holy Diver and Last in Line is that when we did Holy Diver and Last in Line, everyone was in the studio all the time. We were all there, like, offering encouragement. There was a really good vibe. And then nobody went home early. Everyone was, you know, waiting for everything and excited by every little development in those records. When we were doing the Sacred Heart album, nobody wanted to hang around. Like, we cut the tracks and was like, oh, okay, I'm gonna go. You done with me? You know? And it was just left Ronnie and Angelo, our engineer, and it was because of that energy, that vibe that was coming from Ronnie at that time. And so it was really, really difficult to make. I'm not saying it's a bad record, but it was really difficult for us, for Vinny and Jimmy and myself, and obviously for Ronnie to make it. So at that time, that We Are the World thing had come out, you know, with all the Michael Jackson and all the pop stars, and made this great record. And Jimmy and I, who were roommates at the time, we were living in an apartment together, happened to do an interview for a station called KLOS in Los Angeles. And the DJ asked us, he said, how come nobody from the hard rock world was invited to participate in that? And we thought, you know, you're absolutely right. And this was an era when hard rock was really sort of shunned. I mean, it never got nominated for a Grammy or anything. There was no real industry recognition, even though it was a very, very popular cultural force and sold in multi-millions, you know, but the industry was yet to really fully recognize it as being legit. And so anyway, we were joking about this, and it was Jimmy who was a funny guy, and Jimmy, like, right off the bat said, yeah, we should do one, we should call it Hearing Aid. We were all like, ah, we fell off our stools. And then we went back to our apartment, and Jimmy said, well, do you want to actually do this? And really? I mean, do we have time for this? And he said, yeah. Okay, so Jimmy and I wrote the song. We didn't write the lyrics. We put the music together, and we thought, we're not going to get this off the ground without Ronnie. I mean, we need some clout. We need the name. So we went into the studio the next day. As I said, we're in the middle of doing a Sacred Heart album. Ronnie's in a real dark spot. We offer it, and we say, Ronnie, what about this? He immediately shuts it down. No interest. So we keep pushing on him for a couple of weeks, and then eventually he came back to us and said, you know what? Yeah, I'll get on board with this. So he wrote the lyric for it. I, with the help of a publicist we were working with at the time, went to the office every day with a publicist. She let me go through her Rolodex, like, this is how old school this is, like, Rolodex, you know, and look up me, and I'd go, oh, John Bon Jovi, you know, and I'd literally be calling people, yeah, cold calling people that I didn't know, you know. And I remember talking to John Bon Jovi's mother. I never got John on the phone, but hey, this is Jovi, Bon Jovi, what is your name? You don't know me, but, you know, I play guitar with Dio. Who? Dio, Ronnie James. Who? You know, it's okay. And trying to explain, you know, we're making this charity record, and we'll cover expenses, you know, we'll get some sponsorship. So That was my life for weeks, every day, going into a whole different world for me, you know, just getting on the phone and calling people. Hi, Neil, Sean, yeah, love your journey stuff, you know.
And you're like 22 here.
Yeah. Is there any chance you could, you know, who else is doing that? The same old thing, like nobody wants to commit until, but, you know, I was able to throw Ronnie's name there and say, well, Ronnie's doing it, you know.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. And, you know, calling up studios like NM Studios, hey, is it possible we can get a day free in the studios for charity? You know, hey, American Airlines, is there any way, you know, we can, hey, Holiday Inn, can you, you know, it was something I'd never done before, but, you know, I spent weeks and weeks and weeks doing it. And so it all came together and it was just bonkers that it did. And then, like, I remember the day we were doing it at A&M and, you know, with film crew in there. And the guys from Spinal Tap even showed up, you know, and that made it great because that brought a little much-needed humor to the whole situation. And all these great guitar players, you know, we had Yngwie there and George Lynch and Neil Sean, you know, and guys who were like blazing guitar. And I just remember I was so busy making sure that everyone had a limo ride, had a flight, had a hotel room, had something to eat, you know, and then at the end of the day, it's like, okay, now you got to play guitar. It's like, what?
It's such a great piece of rock history. That's why I just had to ask. I haven't heard you talk about it too much, and I thought it must have been. I know how bad it's just to organise like a dinner, a night out, yeah. You know, to put together, you know, something that was incredible. Look, Viv, thanks for taking some time to talk to us today. I hope you have a great night. Looking forward to
my retreat. Thank you for making the effort to get dressed up.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, I know. I'll get some long because I know I can't outdo these shoes. That's
what. Oh, yeah. You can't even see them. Yeah. All for now. Oh well.
Great to see you.
You too.